On the service bench is a 1961 Akai model M5 reel-to-reel tape recorder. In this video, I'll be sharing the process of restoration of this machine. In particular, I'll be showing how to replace the motor run capacitor and also how to replace the motor mounts. I'll also touch base on recapping the amplifiers. So if you have one of these machines, or any of the other Akai M series, or perhaps one of the Roberts counterparts, such as the models 990, the 997, or the 770X, for example, you'll see that the machines are more or less the same in their overall design and construction. Major differences being in some features, of course, and some styling differences. A little bit of history on these. The machines were marketed in the United States under the Roberts brand. And there's actually a good documentary on YouTube with an interview of Robert Metzner, who was the founder of Roberts Electronics. And he describes how he helped develop this machine with Akai, and basically described how he sent them an American Ampex 600 series machine and asked them to recreate it under his own brand name. That's pretty much what we have here, is a copied version of an Ampex 600. And these are great machines. Now, the Akai name didn't make its way to the United States until 1971. Like I said, these were all marketed under the Roberts name before then. And this one being an Akai, it made its way back to the U.S. from Americans in the military. And that's typically the case with any pre-1971 Akai machine. So the original owner of this was a gentleman in the U.S. Navy. He served between 1960 and 1962. And he brought this machine home with him. So we'll take a look at some of the features. This is a 4-track stereo machine. Here's the track selector knob. Got the play, fast forward, rewind knobs. And here's the speed change lever. And the speed change on these machines was done mechanically by changing the belt position. Later machines used electrical switching at the motor, which was a much more reliable setup. And these are tube type machines. Tubes are behind this metal perforated grill. We've got two illuminated VU meters. Here's the original owner's manual. Here's the gentleman that originally owned it. Mr. Dobbs, again, served in the U.S. Navy for 3 years, from 60 to 62. It looks like he got a lot of use out of this machine. He took really nice care of it. He has all kinds of notes that he wrote on the operation. And here's the vinyl bag with the accessories. The microphones. And some auxiliary connection cables. Here are the speaker extension leads. And he also purchased these Allega stereo headset. These are also made in Japan. So these were with the machine as well. And also are the original Akai stereo speakers. These are the model SS60. is a look at the name badge here. These just clip together. And you've got a carry handle on the back, like you can see. You could switch between flat and bass, and there's the input. So that's the overall machine and the accessories that came with it. And as for operating the machine, typically they'll work in some way, shape, or form when you find them. And this machine, the motor drive seemed to be working fine. I was using it, and after about a half hour, suddenly the machine really slowed down, and it just creeped at a very slow speed. So I immediately shut it off, and I put my hand on the motor, and it was burning hot. And the motor run capacitor was equally as hot. And the capacitors are notorious failures on these machines. It should have been the first thing I replaced, but I didn't do that right away. And the amplifiers also worked, but there was definitely some issues with the frequency response. And that was resolved by recapping the amplifier. And I also needed some new drive belts, and the motor mounts as well were in need of replacement on these machines. So let's go ahead and start off with the process of replacing the motor run capacitor. We'll start and disassemble this machine. Pretty straightforward machine to begin taking apart. Let's take a look at the back. Here's a look at the rear of the machine with the access panels removed. And here is the motor run capacitor that we're going to replace. You can see it's the aluminum can type capacitor. And it has a mounting bracket that mounts to the side of the motor. And unfortunately, we can no longer find an original type capacitor of this dimension, so we have to make up a new mounting bracket for new axial metallized polypropylene capacitors. And fortunately, we've got plenty of space, it looks like, inside the cabinet to do that. So I'm shining a flashlight in here. You can see we have plenty of space to work with. So the first thing, obviously, we need to do is pull the transport out of the cabinet. And in order to do that, we need to remove the mono amplifiers. We got a left and right. And we just have to remove the bracket for the record. And the cables and jacks, everything just plugs in with connectors. So it's a straightforward machine to disassemble. So we'll go ahead and do that. We now have the tape transport removed from the cabinet. Now we can clearly see all the components that we have to work with. And here's the original motor run capacitor that needs to be replaced. We can see it's a two-section capacitor, and it has a common ground. It's rated at 2.2 microfarads. 0.6 microfarads and rated at 300 volts AC. And it also has the year stamped in it, 1961 in this case. So we know that this machine was made in 1961. That's a helpful tip if you work on these Akai or Roberts recorders and you're curious what year the machine was made. If you have the original motor run capacitor like this one, take a look on that capacitor and see what the year is. It's about your only way to really pinpoint when these were made. But unfortunately, these capacitors are either failed or about to fail at this point. At the time of this recording here, this machine's 59 years old. So I'd like to keep this capacitor if it was still good, but unfortunately it gets hot and the motor slows down, so it's past its usable life. So what we're going to do is come up with a new capacitor arrangement to replace this whole assembly. We're going to mount it in a similar fashion to the original here. You can see we've got plenty of room to work with, like we saw when this was still in the cabinet. We know that this has to clear the cabinet, the top of the motor frame. So I've got all this vertical clearance to work with. So some things to consider when coming up with a new arrangement is we want to make sure we have ease of accessibility to the mounting screws. That's because this bracket mounts to the side of the motor frame like we can see here. And also has a small Z bend. We have the original hardware here that clamps the capacitor to the bracket itself. So we need clearance for that hardware so it doesn't hit the side of the motor frame. And since we're going to be replacing this capacitor with discrete components, we know we're going to have to rearrange the wiring as well. So this will all be mounted, the new capacitors will be mounted on a terminal strip. So these wires will likely be somewhat tucked behind the new capacitor mount. So that's another reason for this additional space. We want a spot for these wires to go behind the new bracket. So with some of the basics considered, the next step is to figure out what type of new capacitors would work. And here are the new replacements. These are a Cornell Dubilier type 940C capacitor. It's a metallized polypropylene type, and they're specifically designed to carry high AC currents, and that'll be ideal for this application. We'll see why in just a moment. We'll take a look at the data sheet. But I had some other options to use, but I just selected the type 940C. And you'll see I've got three capacitors, even though I've got two that need to be replaced. That's because that 0.6 microfarad value, I can't get that value as a single capacitor. So I have to run two in parallel to achieve that value or get very close to it. And ultimately I had to go with a 0.15 and parallel it to a 0.47. That gives me 0.62 microfarads, which is about a 3.2% difference from 0.6. So that should be just fine. But the good news is these two capacitors probably really won't ever be used. And that's because the 0.6 value is only used when the machine is switched to be used at 50 Hertz. So these have an internal switch right here to switch between 60 and 50 Hertz. These machines were designed to be used anywhere in the world. So this particular capacitor will probably never get used. I'm here in the United States, but who knows, maybe this machine could go to Europe or anywhere else that's using 50 Hertz. So this 2.2 microfarad capacitor is ultimately going to be doing all the work. But either way, we want to design the new capacitor mount so that we have full capability for line frequency. So we're going to put all those together. And then if we take a look at the data sheet,
Here's the three values. And these capacitors are rated at 850 volts DC. You can see in parentheses it's 450 volts AC. So voltage rating wise, these are adequate. And we also have to consider the operating load that these capacitors are going to see. Now this is a hysteresis synchronous type motor. You can see it's rated at 0.3 amps. So really not much. If we take a look back at the data chart, we can see that the smallest capacitor can handle 5.8 amps at 100 kilohertz. And as the capacitance increases, so does the current capability. So ultimately, this 2.2 microfarad capacitor that's going to be doing all the work can handle 18.4 amps continuously at 100 kilohertz. That's pretty impressive. And this machine's only going to be operating at 50 or 60 hertz. So these capacitors are more than adequate for this application. So they should run nice and cool and be very reliable. So with the capacitors selected, it then became a job to determine how they would be arranged on a terminal strip. And that's what we see here. These are some options that I came up with when figuring out how to mechanically mount this together. Now at the time I was figuring this out, I was considering the type 930 capacitor. That's these two on the left. I didn't go with them because of the voltage ratings. They were a little lower than I wanted. So I went with the type 940C, like I mentioned earlier. So between these two options, it was narrowed down to a single lug mount or a two lug mount terminal strip. And I liked the two mount strip because I figured that perhaps the single mount strip, it could tend to pivot because this is going to mount onto the motor via bracket, and if the motor is not perfectly balanced, this device might potentially shimmy because of this single pivot point. So I figured this was a better idea. Let's go with a two-point mounting scheme. So here's the Keystone Type 828 terminal strip. I drew this to scale so you could see. There it is. And the new capacitor, also to scale. And then I just simply have to bend the leads like they're shown here. And this worked nice because the leads can be cleanly and neatly bent at 90 degrees. And I'll have my 2.2 microfarad connection here, and the 0.62 microfarad connection here, and that would be my common ground. Then from the manufacturer, they gave me I just downloaded it from their website, the data sheet for the number 828 terminal strip. So I was able to, again, draw this to scale. And again, this drawing was just used so I could determine which size strip would work best. So once that was figured out, it became a means of figuring out how to come up with a bracket that would support this terminal strip. So we know the terminal strip's going to be mounted something like this, and we just saw how this original bracket was how this original bracket was made. We would do something similar with a new bracket.
So as I was measuring it, I was roughly drawing some dimensions here, a view of the motor so I could see what I had to work with. You see I did everything in metric. That's because I noticed that as I was measuring things, I was coming up with nice whole numbers if I measured metrically. That's because this machine's made in Japan, so it only made sense. So I stuck with the metric dimensions from this point forward. So here's like a little isometric view of the bracket. And I was just kind of brainstorming how those capacitors would get arranged. And the hole centers for the bracket. So I just took this rough sketch drawing and then came up with the final design detail. And I've got two options once again. I've got an option one and an option two on the right. And here's some views of it. This is a smaller bracket that I came up with. Large capacitor mounts on top. This is a side view. Then here's a larger bracket with the large capacitor on the bottom. And these, from these section views or side views, you can see I can have clear access to the mounting screw that goes into the side of the motor frame. So it was 6 of one, half a dozen the other, on which bracket ended up being best. Ultimately, I liked having the large capacitor down low, so I went with the slightly larger bracket. And I made that bracket right here. It's made out of 22 gauge galvanized sheet metal. And again, this drawing's to scale, so I could just line this right up and you could see how that aligns. I've got a couple more brackets that I made. I also made the small one. So there's the two different brackets. But again, I went with the larger bracket because, again, I wanted the capacitor on the bottom, the large capacitor. It's a bit heavier. And I just liked having it off to the side. This is kind of a heat shield. So it worked pretty good. So, we've got the terminal strip. And it's going to mount like this. We're going to reuse those original screws like we saw. We got the two screws to mount it to the motor. And the two original bracket screws will mount the terminal strip. So if we go back to the machine here, you just hold this up for comparison's sake. That's going to be how this works. And you can see I made the Z-bend a little wider. I made it an 8mm wide Z-bend. Like I show here, I've got the forming detail. Oops, hold it the other way. So I've got plenty of space for the mounting hardware, and I've got that pocket to run the wires. So we'll go ahead and assemble all these components together. With the capacitors, we'll be able to build it like a little assembly. And we'll be able to take this little assembly and just mount it right to the motor frame and solder the new wires on. And then we should have a finished product. So let's see how it all turns out. Okay, here's a look at the new completed capacitor assembly on the left. You can see we've got the new bracket assembly and the terminal strip. And of course the three new capacitors. So all that needs to be done at this point is to just mount the new assembly and solder the leads into place. So here's a look at the capacitors in a side-by-side comparison. And the original here is just slightly heavier in overall weight. So that's an advantage that the new assembly's just a little bit lighter. And another thing worth pointing out is that this original capacitor is not an oil-filled type. It is a paper and foil type construction. So again, that just makes the selection of the metallized polypropylene capacitors an ideal replacement for this application. So here we can compare the completed assembly with the design drawing. And it pretty much turned out the way I designed it. Everything lines right up. Here's a side view comparison. We've got plenty of space to safely solder the leads. And again, we've got that clearance for the original mounting screws so that the shank of the screwdriver doesn't have to interfere. So the original wires here, some are slightly short, so I'll have to lengthen those. And then that should be about all that needs to be done at this point. We'll just mount this new assembly here. And again, we'll solder the wires in, and this should be a completed project. Here's a look at the completed installation. Here's the new bracket mounted to the motor frame, and the new wires have been lengthened as needed and soldered onto the terminal strip. We've got this space between the bracket and the motor frame like we talked about to give us clearance for the hardware. It also gave us this channel to run the wires. So if I give this an integrity test here, it's a nice solid bracket. So that completes the motor run capacitor portion of the project. And lastly, I'll touch base on some of the other restoration points I had to take care of on this machine. So let me start off by saying that I bought the machine earlier this summer, and at the time I started working on it, I did not intend to do any type of video documentation on the progress. And since I had to take it apart again to replace the capacitors here for the motor, I figured, well, why not just touch base on the other items that needed to be addressed. So, and I'll just mention what I originally had to do was replace the three motor mounts, new drive belt, and also recap the amplifiers. We'll take a look at the amplifiers too in just a moment. So here's a look at the new motor mount. Like I said, there's three of these. And this is a new zinc-plated brass spacer, the new vibration isolator, and the shim washers were reused. I also had to replace the original truss head screws, and there's a cheese head screw on the opposite side of the tape deck. And the reason the screws had to be changed is because the lengths did not work for the original screws. So when these motor mounts had to be replaced, it was critical that the dimension between the bottom of the motor frame and the tape deck matched the dimension with the original motor mounts. And that's because this dimension here dictates the center of the motor drive pulley. And it has to be on the same center as the flywheel pulley, of course. So here's a look at the three original motor mounts. And what happens with these over time, they don't really dry out, but they become extremely soft. And you can see it doesn't take much force for me to bend it out of shape. It can no longer support the weight of the motor. So when this tape deck's in its vertical position, you're putting this motor mount in shear, which is force perpendicular to the center line. And when that happens, with these motor mounts being weak, the motor just drops down and I lose belt tension. So let's take a look at the other side of the tape deck. We could see some of these other details. Okay, here's a look at the other side of the tape transport. You can see with the new motor mounts installed that the center of the motor shaft is also properly centered in this opening in the deck plate. And that's also critical because this shaft needs to be in the proper position in which to engage with these drive idlers. So it's very critical that the motor mounts be in good shape on these machines. Here's a look at the original mount again. We'll compare it with the new setup. You can see that the overall heights are the same. With the smaller mount, I had to add the brass spacer here. And again, reused the original shim washers. And the new mount had the proper 4mm thread, so I was able to maintain the original 4mm screws as well. And that also meant no drilling any of the holes. And that's one thing I never like doing on repair or restoration work, is doing any type of hole drilling or other type of irreversible modification. The diameter is 3/4 of an inch. And the original, the new mount diameter is 5/8. We'll take a look. I had some options to work with on the diameters, but I ended up having to select the smaller diameter mount. Because if you look down here, I have a very tight clearance between the belt change lever and the motor mount. And with the original mount, this just cleared. So unfortunately, there were no 3/4 inch diameter mounts that had the proper thread in it. We'll take a look here. Back when I was working on the mechanical portion of this,
in August of this year. I was coming up with some ideas on how I would make the new motor mount work. And I use all the hardware I acquire from McMaster Car. So once I came up with the idea that worked, I drew it up, just like I did for the capacitor mount. I had two options, because I always like coming up with at least two different ideas. So I had the option one and option two, and this ultimately was the winner. This is the one that you see on the machine right now. And I've got the McMaster Car numbers pointed out on all of the new components and hardware. So if you have to do this to your machine, please by all means feel free to use this as a reference. So here's the spacer. Here's the new vibration isolator, which I also call the motor mount. Here's the original shim washers. And here is the wire standoff that's on one of the mounts. So I had to use a longer screw for that one. That's why I show this dotted. I'm kind of showing two different scenarios on the same drawing here. Take a look. There's that standoff for the AC line. I had to use this longer screw. There's the cheese head screw. Just like the original here. Slotted cheese head screw. And then we've got the Phillips truss head like the original on this side. So again, I like to try to keep things close to original. So that's how that worked. And this was my option two, and I did not go with this. And like the I'll explain why I called it out earlier, but this was a 1-inch diameter mount. It only had an M8 thread, so I had to use a M8 by M4 threaded bushing. And the reason this didn't work, that 1-inch diameter like you saw earlier, it gave me an interference issue with that belt change bracket. And I didn't want to do any type of modification to the new mount, like cutting off a piece of rubber. I liked that it was bigger in diameter, and it was also the proper height. But it was better to go with this option, I thought. And these are neoprene rubber. It's has a durometer rating of 50A, so it's a nice solid piece, and these new mounts can handle 25 pounds in shear, so these are certainly good for this application. I've got three mounts at 25 pounds max each. The motor only weighs maybe 2 pounds. So we're certainly not overloading them. So on the mechanical restoration, I'll also point out that I also had to take the motor off this mounting plate, because inside these motors is also an oil wick. It's basically a piece of polyurethane foam, and over time it breaks down and turns into dust. Very similar like you see on old transistor radios with the
foam on the battery cover, it breaks down and turns into dust. It's the same thing. So you have to pull the motor off the plate, and this end cap here, you just pry this off with a screwdriver, and there's an oil wick, and you just remove the old oil wick, and you get a new piece of polyurethane foam. And I got this from McMaster Car as well. Here's the number. And you cut it in a circular shape like this. Motor shaft goes through the middle. And then you saturate this with oil. And then this will, in turn, go up against the oil light bushing inside the motor. Unfortunately, there is no external oil port on this end of the motor shaft. So once you have this oiled, that's pretty much your only way of keeping it oiled, unless you take the whole thing apart again. The backside of the motor does have an oil port, which you could see right here. But that polyurethane foam's in the front, so that usually needs to be replaced. So that's about all that needed to be done on the mechanical portion of the machine. Let's go ahead and plug it in and give it a quick bench test of the motor now. I put a jumper wire on here, because this socket here, that goes to the power switch on the main amplifier, so I was able to jumper it. Got the main power cord here. Let's turn it on. There it goes. Motor took off right away. It's running nice and smooth. Very little vibration. So let's let this cook out for a little bit. Want to prove that this is all in good shape before we put it all back together. And in the interim, we'll take a look at the amplifier and the work that went into that. Here's a look at the amplifiers for the tape deck. We've got the left channel and right channel. They're both modularized units. And both are basically the same, as you'd expect. The only difference with the left channel amp is that it contains the 6AR5 tube, which is used as the bias oscillator for the record function. You can see there's a missing tube right here. It's the same chassis. In fact, they just changed the locations of the low voltage rectifiers in the amplifiers as well. They put the 6X4 over here on the right channel, and on the left channel amp, the 6X4 is right here. So we'll take a look at the bottom of the amplifier and we'll see all the capacitors that had to be replaced. Here's a look at the bottom of the left channel amplifier. And again, it's basically the same as the right channel amp. So we'll just take a look at the bottom of this one here. What was done here was done to the right channel. So you can see we've got the new axial units here, these yellow capacitors. There's about 7 or 8 of these caps in each of the amps. There's this removable metal shield here. There's a couple more underneath, like this one back here. And this one here has this coil shield wrapped around it, like the original one had. These are fairly simple and straightforward amps to recap. Capacitor values are common, like 0.01 and 0.022 microfarad. It's just a couple capacitors that are somewhat difficult to get at, like this one back here. You can see it's buried back there, and it solders to this function switch. You have to desolder these two leads, actually these three leads, then you have to get at the lead that's all the way in back. There's another row of terminals behind these, so that's kind of a difficult one to do. And then there's this one right here across the output transformer. You have to desolder some of the other parts to get access to them. But you can also see that I left the electrolytics alone. I've mentioned this in my other videos. I typically like to leave electrolytics alone only if the ESR tests low. And by low, I'm talking about generally anything under 5 ohms. Now, of course, that value varies based on the value and voltage of the capacitor. But for all practical purposes, say anything under 5 ohms is a good electrolytic. So all these tested good. And generally, I don't have problems with electrolytics that test well. You can put this thing in service and they hold up. So this multi-section capacitor here, this was also good. But unfortunately, the film capacitors are always going to be bad. And here's some of the originals. These are the ones that came onto the right channel amplifier. These are the ones out of the left. Here's one of the originals. It's a Nippon Chemicon 0.02 at 400. They call this an oil capacitor, but if you take it apart, it's really just a paper and foil capacitor. But these are always leaky. They'll leak at the lowest setting of your capacitor tester. So at 25 volts, these things are leaking. They basically turn into resistors. So any of your vintage Japanese electronics that use these, or any type of variant, they have to go. So I take a look at this again. And again, this is actually a paper and foil capacitor as well. I should have replaced it back when I was doing the amplifiers and the motor mounts, but I failed to do so. I rolled the dice and I paid for it. But that's good because it let me reconsider my options and I decided to make this video. So these are bad because it's basically a paper and foil capacitor. Electrolytics, though, typically going to be okay. So we're going to let the tape transport continue to cook out as we test the motor and the new capacitor. We'll revisit that. See how that's going. Okay, let's do one last look at the tape transport. See how the cookout's doing. It's been plugged in and operating here for almost an hour. The motor frame is just lukewarm. No detectable temperature change on the capacitor. So we'll prove that with the infrared thermometer here. So I'll shoot it at the deck plate. 64 degrees. The motor is about 83, 84. And how about that 2.2 microfarad capacitor? about 64, 65. Look at that, even the deck plate's 65. So there is essentially no temperature rise in that new capacitor. Yeah, maybe a degree. You can't even detect it. There's the motor again. So the fact that the capacitor is still about ambient, and it's been about an hour, that's a great sign. So I think we can call this a done deal. Let's go ahead and put this machine back together. The restoration is now complete. It's time for the final test. And this concludes the repair and restoration to the 1961 Akai M-5. Thanks for watching.